The following feature presentation is part of the SKYwalking NETwork.
Okay, I'm ready.
This is what you can look forward to on episode 280 of SKYwalking Through Neverland.
You want to know what happened next?
Yes. Yeah.
I turned around and I saw him, and it was love at second sight as far as I was concerned. And it turns out that we dated 70 years ago. You have a Costco card? And he said, yes. And you'd let me use it? And he said, yes. I said, will you marry me?
Who knows? I could have loved Max Von Sydow.
And I turned around, there's Max Von Sydow writing back at me, looking at me like, dude, you're so in my spotlight.
This is Margaret Kerry, the original reference model for Tinkerbell for Walt Disney's movies. And I am here with everybody, and we're skywalking through Neverland. Stay tuned.
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey, hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, hey, skywalkers. Hey, what do you have planned for when you're 90 years old? Well, if you need inspiration, well, hang around because we have someone who can help you out and inspire you. But until then, we want to welcome you all to Skywalking Through Neverland. We are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. I am Richard Woloski, but now, everyone, please say hello to my sweetie wife, who just enjoyed another birthday yesterday.
I did! It was another birthday. I was so excited. And we had a lovely day where we just chilled out. We went shopping, because that's one of my favorite things. I told Richard, don't give me anything. We'll just go shopping. And I ended up getting something. I ended up getting something that was really awesome. It's going to be my new gym bag, because my old gym bag was falling apart. And it's Tinkerbell. It's an animator's collection from the Disney store. So I get to look at it every day, and I'm excited because, you know, just a handbag or something I don't get to use every day. But this gym bag, I will use every day. It'll motivate me to go to the gym. So now it is time to give a big Wookiee hug to our family of Skywalkers. We want to thank you guys so much for those of you who are listening to us every single week. And if this is your first time listening to us, well, thank you so, so much. We just love it when you share our joy in this adventure through fandom.
Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on March the 11th, one day after Sweetie's birthday.
Aw.
2020. All right, Sarah, do you want to give us the time?
Oh, okay. It's 12:19. Good afternoon.
That's the best Minnie Mouse I've ever heard you do. Oh, I shouldn't have said that. Let everyone believe that's really Minnie Mouse. Shh. All right, then I'll ask you this, Sarah. Who is sponsoring this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland?
Well, we are being sponsored by Small World Vacations. They are a diamond-level Disney vacation planner travel agency and can help you book your trip to Disney parks around the world. And best of all, their service is free of charge. So head to smallworldvacations.com for a no-obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
All right, now, coming up on this episode, Margaret Kerry returns.
Awesome.
We are so excited about this. Now, for those of you who don't know, in 1953, Margaret was the animation reference model for Tinkerbell in the animated Peter Pan movie. And since we started Skywalking Through Neverland, she has made several appearances, co-hosted a few of our Step in Time spinoff shows, And now she returns to catch us up on her life, including her recent big wedding day.
At 90 years old.
At the age of 90.
Yeah, that's so amazing.
And if you think that 90 would slow someone down, wait until you hear Margaret.
Yeah.
For those of you who like to hear Mark Hamill talk at conventions, you ask him one question, off he goes. She's the same way. And you never want to cut her off. She's got the voice that just makes you want to sit back and know that life is good.
Aw. True. Very true.
Yeah.
Also on this episode, we have shout-outs and...
Things we want to share.
Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
Unfortunately, on March the 8th, we lost another member of the Star Wars, Game of Thrones, Flash Gordon, Exorcist, Hannah and her sister's family. Max Von Sydow passed away at the age of 90. Now, in The Force Awakens, he played Lor San Tekka. He was the guy who gave Poe Dameron the missing piece of the map to Luke Skywalker.
This will begin to make things right. I've traveled too far and seen too much to ignore the despair in the galaxy.
The General's been after this for a long time.
But the General, to me, she's royalty.
And Max also appeared in Spielberg's Minority Report. Sarah, ever see that?
I think so.
Yeah.
That's with Tom Cruise, right?
Good film. Mm-hmm. Martin Scorsese's Shutter Island, one of my favorite Martin Scorsese films.
And really?
He was brilliant in that. And he was in a lot of Ingmar Bergman's films, including The Seventh Seal, where he played chess with death.
Whoa, that sounds cool.
I'm not going to tell you how it turns out.
Okay. Well, Max von Sydow also reportedly turned down the role of Captain Von Trapp in The Sound of Music.
He would have been so good in that.
Yeah. I mean, I love Christopher Plummer, you know, right. But it's because he's Captain Von Trapp, so who knows? I could have loved Max von Sydow.
Now, I've never met Max von Sydow before, but we did meet eye to eye.
Oh.
Yeah, and he gave me a death glare.
What happened?
The first month I was in Los Angeles, I was working for this production company. Since I was interning, they had given me tickets to a film screening at the Directors Guild.
Ooh.
And I was able to walk up the red carpet. I've never walked up a red carpet before in my life. And there was all these photographers and reporters on the sidelines. And there's me. You know how in a couple of episodes ago, we were talking about being somewhere where you don't feel like you belong?
Yes.
So that was me. And in the middle of this red carpet, I froze. It's like, I didn't know what to do. I knew I shouldn't have been there, but which way do you go? You can't go back. Do you go forward? Do you run? And then everyone in unison were looking at me and said, move. Move out of the way. It's like, okay, apparently they don't want me here, so okay. They go, yeah, we want to see Max. And I turn around, and there's Max von Sydow right in back at me, looking at me like, dude, you're so in my spotlight.
Oh my gosh. So did you scamper off?
Oh, I ran. I ran to the theater and just buried myself somewhere in the shadows.
Wow. Celine says she liked him as the Guardian in Doctor Who. Oh, cool. See, that's a franchise we don't know.
Good deal. Now, as you can imagine, Twitter was flooded with comments like this one from Kevin Smith. And he writes, the legendary actor who gave us both Brewmeister Smith and Ming the Merciless has finally laid down his king in the eternal chess match. You were in many much more respected movies than Strange Brew and Flash Gordon, but I loved you in those flicks first. Yeah, I should have mentioned that in the beginning, how he was in Strange Brew.
Yeah.
Remember when we just were talking about not belonging somewhere?
Yes.
Yeah, he didn't belong in this film at all. not whatsoever.
Never saw it, yeah.
Now, Jonas Suotimo, a.k.a. Chewbacca.
He said, I'm very sorry to learn of Max von Sydow's passing. I had the pleasure to meet him at the Force Awakens premiere. He was a kind and legendary actor. Even with his many achievements, he seemed so enthusiastic about his part in the new trilogy. My thoughts go to his family and friends.
Oh, very, very nice.
Yeah.
Now, here is Max on the red carpet for the European premiere for The Force Awakens in 2015, talking about how it feels to be a part of the Star Wars saga, what impressed him in the original Star Wars film, and the message of hope.
It's very exciting to be part of it. I've been admiring George Lucas all through his career. I think this idea with the Star Wars world and the Star Wars, how should I say, enthusiasm, I think has been very important for so many people. And it's very nice to be allowed to be a little bit part of that. I was very taken in the very first one by, for example, Alec Guinness, who was the first Jedi, really. And I think Harrison Ford has done a great job all through the series, because he is really one of us. And he's an awfully strong actor. I admire him. The film has a philosophy with some hope. And we need that today.
So, Max, you will be missed.
Situation's almost under control out there. How's it going in here?
I'm still trying to decrypt Echo's cerebral interface. Until I do, we cannot disconnect him from this computer system.
How is he, Rex?
He's too weak to walk. Very disoriented. Doesn't even remember how he got here. He remembers being at the Citadel, but that's about it.
Any word on the extraction squad?
We called it in, but no word back.
Clone Wars Season 7, Episode 3, on the Wings of Keeradaks. All right, Richard, you want to read the summary for this episode?
Rex has found his friend Echo in the clutches of the Techno Union, but the rescue is just beginning. And the fortune cookie reads, survival is one step on the path to living.
There you go. So
there's a lot of people I want to tell that to.
Oh, right. Yeah, so Echo, of course, is survived these past, what, couple years, but not very well, but he is still alive. And as you see in this episode, he ends up helping his friends.
So this picks up right where a distant Echo left off. That was the last episode. And the Bad Batch is holding off the security praying mantis droids. And Rex is trying to unhook Echo, who is still patched into the system security computers.
Yeah, they can't just pull that plug, because who knows what's going to happen, because there's like a plug directly into his brain. And
all right,
that's no good.
I want to finalize a debate we had last week.
Yes.
I'm not saying who was wrong and who was right.
Okay.
But when Echo was saying, Rex, you came back for me?
Right.
I was thinking he meant you came back right here for me.
Yes. And I was thinking he was still back in time at the Citadel.
At the Citadel, in that time period.
Right.
Now, I'm not going to say who was right, who was wrong. But it seemed like, yes, he was saying, Rex, you came back, because he still thought he was at the Citadel.
Right,
and
right.
I thought he meant right then and there, so I'm not going to say who was right and who was wrong.
But I'll say it. I was right. Richard was wrong.
You know what? I was trying to be so civilized. What happened? Let's just move on.
All right. All right, well,
so what do you think about this episode now that this debate is over?
Oh, okay. So the debate is over. I won, clearly. Mm-hmm. But
it's still your birthday week, so yes. We'll say that you won.
So our thoughts are, well, my thoughts on this episode, I thought it was another fun episode that demonstrated the skills of the Bad Batch. You know, like Wrecker got to boost a bunch of his friends up in the air. Crosshair was seeing how many droids were there through the walls. And even Echo plays a part, because he finds the escape route because he knows it in his head. Overall, though, like, it was my least favorite of the three so far. And I'll get into why a little later, because there's some plot points that I didn't quite agree with. So,
well, I see where you're going with that. Mm-hmm. I think they could have rolled the story elements of this episode into the last episode, A Distant Echo, and the other half into the next episode, which is premiering this week.
Sure.
Unfinished Business.
Okay.
So not a lot happened in this.
Right, right.
But they had to fill out 22 minutes with something, and boy, they did.
Yes.
Because these battle sequences were phenomenally animated, phenomenally shot, phenomenally lit, and I love so much that they're using the Lucas long shot, and that's where the camera pulls back, and you get to see the spatial relations of everyone in this battle.
That's a very good point.
If you look at movies nowadays, they cut into all these, they edit together all these inserts, so you don't know who's winning a fight, where anyone is. And Lucas would always pull the camera back and go, this is where everyone is.
Right.
And this is where the battle is. And that one shot I'm thinking about in particular when you have Anakin and the Bad Batch on this long tube that connects both sides of the city.
Yep.
And on one side you have the security battle droids, and the other side you have more security battle droids. That shot, I need to freeze frame and blow it up and put it on the wall.
Or maybe your computer desktop background.
Well, okay. That too.
But yeah, no, that was a great shot.
All right. So what standout moments really caught you, Sarah?
Well, I guess I'll just go off of what you said with that long shot. And to me, that really reminded me of Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, when they're over that rope bridge and you have that same thing happening. You have that the natives coming on one side, and then, you know, he's about natives coming on the other, and Indiana raises his sword to cut the rope in half. And similarly, did Anakin raise his lightsaber? I don't think so, but...
Well, he did to fight the battle droids.
Right, right. Yeah.
But not now. He didn't slice the tube.
No, he didn't slice the tube.
But he should have.
Yeah, that would have been cool.
Because there's another movie homage they pay in this.
Oh, yes.
This should have been just nothing but movie homages.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And that scene when Tech calls the Keeradaks, he has a special signal, he calls the Keeradaks, they all jump in and escape. And then what happens with the praying mantis droids? they fly now. Who knew this could happen?
Wait, they fly now?
They fly now.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, that was cool. Okay, I guess that was a standout moment for me too. I loved in this episode how they did add things that were different that we haven't seen. You know, you have these praying mantis battle droids instead of the regular battle droids, and they're so skinny because we learn why, because they have those wings. So that's pretty cool. And then later on, there's these big giant round fighting droids too, like the destroyer droids, I guess, that can also fly. So
yeah, those big spider droids with the Death Star head.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, another great design. Mm-hmm. Now, another homage that I was referring to earlier is when the security battle droid came back to Watt Tambor to give him the news. And Watt says, okay, go back and get my experiment, which is Echo. And the security battle droid flies off, and hundreds of other security battle droids fly off right behind him.
That's a long shot into the night.
Yeah, it's such a Wizard of Oz moment. Fly, you monkeys, fly!
Yes.
Now fly! Fly!
Ugh. I also had that written down for my Easter eggs, too. But yeah, I agree with you. That was really cool. And you can't help the Wizard of Oz thing. Like, it's just the Wizard of Oz flying monkeys.
Well, I love it when they go outside of Star Wars to make reference to other classic film moments.
Mm-hmm.
And that definitely was a Wizard of Oz moment.
Well, you know what? Since we're going on these Easter eggs for other films, I'm going to name one more Easter egg that I saw. And that is back in the control room when the Bad Batch is still trying to escape and all the droids are closing in on them. Our Bad Batch manages to close the doors, but before they can close them, the droids get their little fingers in there and try to open the doors, and one of the droids sticks his nose in, and it's just like so much like a raptor from Jurassic Park, like trying to get through that door before Ellie and Dr. Grant can like close that door. So
that's why you squealed at that one scene.
I did.
Okay, it's like,
I was like, oh, it's Jurassic Park. Yeah. And it was like almost exactly how his snout moved too. I don't know. It was really neat.
Another Easter egg I want to point out, this is a very small Easter egg. The cod piece that Echo is wearing is very similar to the codpiece Darth Vader wears.
You would notice this. I did not notice this.
Only Vader's was black and Echo had a white version on. Yes, I do notice things like that. All right, now let's get to the end.
Okay.
And Watt Tambor realizes that they lost Echo to the clones, and he needs to find a way to recoup on their investment.
The loss of the clone is a devastating blow to the Techno Union's profit margin. We must find a way to recoup on our investment.
What do you think that means? They lost Echo. They put a lot of time and money into extracting information from him.
Well, this might come up in the next episode, which is the final episode. Like, does this come back in Revenge of the Sith? I don't think so.
And I've been racking my brain. How can he recoup on this loss?
Try to steal another...
A couple of droids? Clones.
Yeah, clones. Maybe he's trying to get some of the Bad Batch members. That'd be interesting.
Yeah. I'm very interested in where that line leads to.
Chris Marino says they think that they're going to control him to attack everyone else. So almost like Order 66. Like
Yeah, because in the end, Echo says to Rex,
Rex, thanks for coming after me. That's what brothers do. I'm just sorry it took so long. Hopefully it's going to be just like old times. Yeah, just like old times.
And then the camera, we stay on Echo, and there's not really a glint in his eye, like there's something there. There's no dun-dun-dun moments. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that's just like a throwaway line. You wouldn't think so, but there's nothing to make you think that that's going to lead to something. And normally they would do that. They would show the clone squinting his eyes like villains do, or have that dun-dun-dun moment.
Right. Well, there's no throwaway lines in these episodes.
Exactly.
Everything is there for a reason. So you know this will come back. I didn't get that whole... Like, yeah, you're right. There's no sinisterness to it. But I just think that Echo is sad, and that what he's been through means that it has changed him. And so things can never be the same again because, you know, he has changed.
Right. But the way the camera stayed on Echo.
Right.
And Rex had left, it just implied so much more.
Okay.
So there's a couple of cliffhangers.
Right. Well, the main plot point I didn't appreciate in this episode.
That you didn't appreciate?
Yeah, I did not like. Anakin and the clones, when they got on the Keeradaks, that they returned to the Poltex village, like the native village, because automatically that involved the Poltex in this war that they said they didn't want to be in. So, you know, by returning to the Poltex, Anakin and the clones absolutely brought the war to that village. And then they just tried to, you know, show them Echo and say, see what they did to our man? Well, you know, they're bad. So help us fight.
The war was already there. They just didn't know it because they didn't know that Wat Tambor was part of the Separatists.
Right, but what
and that's when Anakin had to tell him, yeah, no, Wat Tambor of the Techno Union, guess what? He already brought the war here to your planet, so it's been here dormant up until now. So one way or another, it was going to surface, and it's better now that they have Anakin and the clones on their side rather than attacking them when they're not expecting it.
Well, okay, and that's another point I had. Yes, Wat Tambor, they sent an attack on the village just then when the Bad Batch was there to help them. But who's to say that after, you know, Anakin and the clones leave, who's to say that they don't send another attack to decimate the village later? Like, I just didn't like the fact that Anakin and the clones, they should have just returned to their ship and left the planet as soon as they could, rather than implicating the Poltex.
Well, it wasn't that easy. They couldn't just tell the battle droids, hey, stop shooting at us for about 10 minutes while we pack up and leave. No, the battle droids were right on their tail.
Were they?
Yes. And their ship was there. And I see what you mean, like in the Avengers.
Yes.
When you see so much destruction, don't bring it to New York City. Don't bring it to where all these people in the population are. Get it far, far away. But
yeah.
I think he just needed to get to his ship, warn the Poltex that they were coming, because sooner or later this was going to happen.
Okay, so you think it was inevitable that the Poltex would have been involved?
Easily. Oh, yeah. Very, very much so.
Okay.
One way or another. And I'm sure the Poltex would have moved their camp somewhere else.
I hope so, but that's another thing. Like, now you made these guys move. Come on. Come on, Anakin.
It's war.
I know.
Nothing is fair in war.
I know. So, I mean, basically, to sum up, that's why this episode is my least favorite so far.
Okay.
Just because of that. And there's no moments of levity like Obi-Wan saying, oh, hope you had a nice chat with Padme. You know, stuff like that.
This episode was all just about war.
Mm-hmm.
And which is why we keep going on about how this could have been split up into the last episode taking half of the plot and the next episode taking the other half of the plot. But still, I think I like this episode just because of the cinematic qualities.
Okay.
Story-wise, we got about 3 minutes.
Yeah.
All right. Now, before we move on, let me ask you this. Next episode is the last of this arc.
Mm-hmm.
So which of the Bad Batch will not make it?
All right. So I'm thinking possibly maybe Crosshair or even Hunter. Hunter's like the main, you know, guy.
Yeah. Rambo.
Yes. So I think Hunter, if Hunter were to be lost, I think that would be a big blow. And if that's where they want to go with that.
With that, they have another character to take his place, which is Captain Rex. So Hunter and Captain Rex are pretty much the same character. Mm. Whereas the others, there isn't really another Heavy or Crosshair or Tech.
Right.
Now,
who do you think?
Christopher Marino on,
yes.
on Facebook just said Echo.
Oh, okay.
But we're talking the Bad Batch. I don't think Heavy's going to see the end of the next episode.
Hmm. I don't know. Heavy's there for the kids. Like, he's kind of that levity.
He is, but that's the first clone that came to my mind.
Okay. All right.
So we'll see. You say
Crosshair.
Crosshair, and I say Heavy. So, by the way, this has been going. You're going to be right. So we'll see. We'll see next week.
Yeah.
All right, Skywalkers, what do you think? Let us know. Go on our Facebook page. We'll put this up on in our group.
Yep.
And tweet at us.
At Skywalking Pod.
On the wings of Keeradaks. Up and above the clouds, the only way to fly is on the wings of Keeradaks. On the wings of Keeradaks. Only the two of us together fly. Keeradaks.
Now, Sarah, before we roll into our conversation with Margaret Kerry, the original Tinkerbell, let's hear this birthday wish she left just for you.
This is Margaret Kerry, also known as Tinkerbell for Walt Disney, and I don't ever say happy birthday. I say happy, happy, special, special day, and I know it will be. And here's faith and trust and a whole bunch of pixie dust. That was for you, Sarah.
One of the first big guests we ever had on Skywalking Through Neverland was none other than Margaret Kerry. She was the animation reference model for Tinkerbell in the original animated Walt Disney's Peter Pan in 1953.
After so many appearances on our show, Margaret was crowned our fairy pod mother. And now we are so excited to have her back so she can catch us up to speed on what she's been doing, including her very special Valentine's Day.
So now let's spread some faith, trust, and pixie dust and welcome Margaret back to the show. Hey, hey, Margaret!
Hey, here I am. How you doing? Everything is just fine? You're thinking happy thoughts?
Oh, every day we think of you and we think happy thoughts.
There you go. It's important, you know. It really, really is. I even have happy thoughts every once in a while about losing an hour last night or the other night with daylight savings time. I keep saying, it's okay, I will find it 6 months from now. You know? So you keep... It's a happy thought, right?
Absolutely. That's what we love about you. You're always thinking positively.
Absolutely. It's the only way. And I'm positively happy. I'm positively delighted. Things have changed in my life a wee bit. But I just got off the phone for some people that I'm going to give a talk at a university and talk about my favorite, Mark Davis and Tinkerbell. So I'm smiling from ear to ear.
Well, speaking of your life changed in a very big way last Valentine's Day. Do you want to tell us about that?
Oh, you heard about that, did you?
It was trending all over the Disney sites.
Yes.
You know that the story is in LA Magazine in the March issue? Yeah, I know. It was in the Sarasota Magazine in the February issue at Sarasota, Florida. And the story is basically, it's a Disney story. I had been a widow for 20 years. I was about to turn 90, and I knew I was going to leave California. I didn't know where I was going, didn't know what I was going to do. I just knew that it was about time. I had lived all my life there. And I get this wonderful email, and it's from... New Amsterdam. And it's about somebody that I knew 70 years ago. And I tell you, I gave a little tweak when I read his name. And the question was, would I like to get in touch with Bob Bokey? And I thought, oh, that would be wondrous. How long ago was it? And it turns out that we dated 70 years ago.
Wow.
And I went to work on ABC and also doing the, I did the Ruggles show on that and also going on to be Tinkerbell. And he went to work for, after graduating from USC, he went to work for Mobil Oil and he was transferred. So we didn't see each other after that, but I remembered him so well. And it seems that he remembered me. So when he got to France, he was a World War II veteran, and he was over in Europe to go to the commemoration of the 75th anniversary of D-Day on Normandy Beach. And he was in Amsterdam. I said New Amsterdam before. It's Amsterdam. Mm. To pick up the ship that was going to tour the different places and then take them at the very end to D-Day. And he was walking down the street in Amsterdam, and he turned around with his friends, and he turned around and he said, it says Tinkerbell Toys. And he said, did I ever tell you that I knew Tinkerbell? That I dated her and we had a wonderful time? And somebody from the group said, well, let's see whether we can find her.
Oh.
So I have a website which is pretty prominent called Tinkerbell Talks. And they found how to email going to the website. And they sent it on to me. And, well, my heart just stopped. It was just a delight to even think of him. He was just a very, very precious young man. And I was too young to date anybody, really, at that time. I knew nothing of the world. I had started to work when I was 4 years old in show business. So I lived in show business. I had no idea going to college. He was a USC graduate. I had no idea of how you talk to anybody who was an ex-serviceman. I had no idea, but he was charming and delightful, and I introduced him to Zuma Beach, and he had never forgotten that. So he phoned me from France.
Oh,
I didn't know it was from France until after we were married. So we went back and forth and chatted and realized that we remembered so many wonderful things. And we just laughed and had a grand time over the phone and every once in a while an email. Mm. And so I have shows to do, you know. I make appearances at these shows all over the country. I have another one coming up in Marshfield, Missouri, and then another one coming up in Dayton, Ohio. And I just finished, well, the big one that we did down in Anaheim. Mm. But so I couldn't just up and leave. I had promised to do a lovely benefit show where they were honoring me. Of course, that just broke my heart. And Tinkerbell. And I'd already said yes several months before I had even gotten the email. But this was in the last of September. And I had to go and do the Andy and Mayberry show up in Mount Airy, which is Andy Griffith's birthday, yeah, and a birthplace. And we turn it into Mayberry Days for 6 days in North Carolina.
That is so cool.
So you want to know what happened next?
Yes. Yeah.
So ask me the question.
So, Margaret, what happened next?
Because I don't want this to be a monologue. I really don't. But it's such a loving story. And so I talked to him. He was living in South Carolina, in Hilton Head, South Carolina. And I said, you know, I'm going to be up in North Carolina. Is there any way that you could make it from South Carolina up or we could meet face to face? And he said, well, I have to have my 94th birthday first. And then Yes, I can. So he got in the car on, I've forgotten the date, but it was on a Thursday. And he got in the car and drove 8 hours to Mount Airy, North Carolina. And he walked in the big room at the golf course where they were having a golf tournament for Andy Griffith. And I turned around and I saw him. And it was love at second sight, as far as I was concerned. There he was.
Was it like a crowded room and you kind of saw each other and everything was like perfect?
No, actually, it was a very empty room and we knew it was going to be because I was signing autographs there. And we were getting ready to do that in this big room that held about 300 people. It was the big clubhouse itself. And then they were going to have the dinner and then give the tournament champions, you know, all of the ribbing that they could and all the honors that they could. And then we entertained them. Oh. So I knew it was going to be empty. So he walked in the door looking around at a big empty place. And there I was. I figured it was more dramatic that way.
And you said you hadn't seen him in 70 years?
70 years.
Wow, he really played the long game, didn't he?
Yeah. He had lost his wife 8 years ago, and so he had been traveling, doing interesting things, playing golf, things that were sort of foreign to me, like playing bridge. I've never played that in my life, and he's not going to teach me. I can tell you that right now because he's an expert at it, and you know, different things. And so one of my favorite stories, and he jumped right in and helped me with everything, moving photos back and forth from one building to another, getting ready, helping people standing in line. He was just right there with me, and we just were having a grand time. And the, let's see, I think it was two mornings later, I didn't have to be at a signing room until about 10 o'clock or something like that. I can't quite remember. So we went to breakfast together. Mm. And he looked at me and he said, I'm going to have to buy a house. Mm. I said, what? And he said, well, you know, my condominium is too small. It's just too small. And he told me later that nothing happens on Hilton Head except 50 golf courses. So, but I looked at him and I thought, you know, he's having fun. He's having fun. So we were laughing back and forth. And he said, but it's got to be near a Costco.
Priorities.
So I said to him in fun, I said, you're a member of Costco's? And he said, yes. And I said, and you have a Costco card? And he said, yes. And you'd let me use it? And he said, yes. I said, will you marry me? and he says, well, if we're going to get serious, we have to figure out how to do this, that, the other. We'll have to get you back there. It's just like that was that.
Oh. Well, things have really changed, Sarah, since I asked you to marry me.
Yeah, no kidding. This is how the new kids do it these days. Yeah.
The interesting part about it, we both laughed as if, you know, and then we realized there was something there. Oh. Anybody who wants to leave their condominium that they moved into a year and a half ago and buy a house, you got to know that there's something there, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So one of the things that I had several shows to do, and I had this Disneyana show that I had promised to do on the 15th of February. Something different that they were doing. They honored Tinkerbell, which was lovely. And in Burbank, which was also unusual, they usually are down in Anaheim. The Disneyana Club is one of the largest ones that they have, and people come from all over. So I thought, oh, the day before is St. Valentine's Day. Huh. And I had always dreamed of being married in the little brown church in the valley in Studio City. That's where Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan were married. and many, many other actors. Just, it only holds 48 people.
Wow.
And it was going to be a wedding with 10 people there. And then we would have the big party the next day that somebody else was going to put on.
And then, you're smart.
And then the next day, it was Walt Disney's Barn Day. And we could say, you know, talk to people and they could meet Robert and all the rest of it. And then the next day we flew to Sarasota where he had bought this lovely home.
Wow.
And we haven't killed each other yet. We haven't hit each other yet. We haven't even shouted at each other yet. As a matter of fact, we've been, what do they call it, years and years ago? Cooing like doves. There you go.
Oh, you guys are both Twitter-pated, I think.
Floyd Norman came to the barn show. Bob Gurr came. Okay, what's his first name? The producer, Han. Why can't I remember? H-A-H-N. Produced Toy Story. Don Hahn.
Oh,
Don
yeah.
Hahn actually came. It was so sweet of him. And at the same time, I got a Twitter sent out by Bob Iger.
Wow.
Telling a story. Yes. And then getting a, what do they call it? A link to the whole story that went out.
Okay.
That was the newspaper story that was in many of the newspapers. And I understand that the pictures from the wedding, which ended up with 31 people there, Robert's four children came and their spouses and their grandchildren. I had no idea. My kids came. I knew that they were coming. But it ended up 31 people, and we had the loveliest time. We like each other. Isn't that neat?
That's, well, who doesn't like you? I mean, come on.
That would be mandatory in a wedding.
Yes.
In a marriage.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, I've watched enough TV shows, sitcoms, where they don't like each other. So, no,
that's
it
true.
It was the pictures are all over the what do they call it? The online. There we go. Wherever I have no idea because they don't let me go on that. You know, 31 hours later, I'm still looking.
Yes, that's true. But,
well, that's pretty much true for everybody.
But I think that the photographer who is the photographer for Disneyana and a whole bunch of different, Stephen Russo is his name. He took pictures of everything. And he thought that my email was up and running, I'm sure, because it just, I don't even know whether it got up and running today, but I'm so he's been sending out the pictures to everybody else.
Oh,
we're having a lovely time.
So then, after that, where did you guys go on your honeymoon?
We didn't. I didn't want to live out of a suitcase again for another 6 months.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, and I moved out of a place that I had been for 15 years. That wasn't easy. In fact, I didn't really make it. I left some stuff. I have to figure out what's going on there. But no, that was hard. And I say when I mention it, because it was the February before, a year ago, February, that I knew that I was going to move. I wish I had started packing then. You know, it just got bigger and bigger. And then when the wedding got bigger and bigger, which happily got bigger and bigger, I was supposed to let them know this and how to do that. And and I mustn't forget Howard Green at Disney. When I approached him and I said, they would all these 31 people or 30 people would love to have a tour of Disney Studios. And he said, sure. And he took us on the most wonderful tour of Disney Studios. And they were just with their mouths hanging open like everybody does when they go. And I felt queen of the walk. I tell you. You know, because I could say hello to this person and hello to that person. You know how you feel?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
This is my stamping ground. So, and he just did the greatest job. He's just a love. He's going to get me in touch with some of the people at Walt Disney World so that I can, talk with them, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm about 2 hours away from Walt Disney World. in Sarasota.
Oh, well, it sounds like you really found your knight in shining armor.
It's fairy tale, because every time that I get into something, I wonder how to do that. There's somebody there. It's marvelous. There's somebody there. This is how you do it. Mm. Online, I've just got to say online because I've never seen it myself. But Christy Vaca up in Richmond decided to fly down just before Christmas, and do a documentary of me of around Hollywood and all the places that I've lived and walked. And I understand they edited it and got it online. And I don't know, a lot of people have watched it, but there I am at the Star for Tinkerbell at the Walk of Fame, and there I am at the houses.
Yeah, that was a great documentary. Sarah and I watched it this morning.
Oh, really? Well, I'll tell Christy and Bella Vaca. Bella is Christy's daughter, and we went everywhere in Uber. And we got this done and that done and the other. It was amazing.
Wow.
So I think it took 4 days. And I think that it took them 6 days to edit it and get it out. They're amazing. They really are. And Bella is a 17-year-old.
Okay.
So that's what's been happening to me.
Do the people in your immediate neighborhood, do they know that Tinkerbell just moved in next door?
No, they don't. And that's such, as a matter of fact, you know that I did voices for Clutch Cargo, the cartoon. Mm-hmm. And I met our neighbor across the street, and I was telling him about Hulu. I hope I'm saying it right. And online, because he was saying something about his computer. He really doesn't use it much. I said, really, you should? They show all the old things like, oh, Peter Pan, and how about Clutch Cargo? He said, Clutch Cargo? Where did you come up with that? And I said, well, they show old-time things. Three Stooges are on there, and then I walked away.
Oh, boy.
yeah.
Little does he know.
But it's just, I want people to know Robert, too, because it's so easy when you have the great character of Tinkerbell behind you mm-hmm. and Disney behind you. That you overshadow people. And I don't ever want that to happen with Robert. He is just a brilliant man and just the dearest man. And I mean, he's fought for the country. He's been an executive with started at the bottom and worked his way up with Mobil Oil. He's lived in 20 different homes in the United States because they would transfer him for troubleshooting to here, there, or the other place, and he would buy a home.
Wow.
Well, you are the perfect definition of a doting wife.
We hold hands. He's a hand holder.
Oh.
Well, I have a question.
Yes.
Well, I'm wondering, when you make your appearances as Tinkerbell, will Bob be there? Like, can fans meet him as well?
I hope so. I hope so most of the time, if he isn't, you know, really swampy busy.
Okay.
As far as I'm concerned, he's part of the team.
Aww.
And, of course, this story, so many people want to meet him. So many of my fans want to meet him and, you know, and give the okay. You know, I mean, let's see who this guy really is.
Is he good enough for our Margaret, our Tinkerbell?
Well, we did see some video of you and Bob at Walt's Barn taken just a few weeks ago when they were giving you your send-off. Can you tell us about that?
It was wonderful. So over we went, and of course, Bob had no idea what it was going to be. His family, some of them came because they didn't have to fly back early. So they did not know what was going to happen at Walt's Barn because most people, and I'm so sorry that people don't get over to Walt's Barn and the Carol Wood Railroad Society at Griffith Park on the third Sunday. I'm giving a plug for Walt's Barn. It's the third Sunday of the month. It's open from 11 to 3. It's the only free event, Disney event in the world.
That's true. And it's amazing. It's really fun,
I'm not processing these words. Disney, free Disney. I can't get my head around that.
I know. Well, are you ready for the second part?
Yes.
We have a huge parking lot, and it's free.
What? In LA?
And you can look it up on the internet under Walt's Barn in Griffith Park, or just say California, Southern California. It's the essence of Walt Disney. There's his desk that he worked at, the chair that he sat in. There's the, the controller for his railroad in his backyard. Mm-hmm. It's a miniature barn. It holds about, I would say, 40 people if they all came in at once. So that's the size of it. And it was built on his property and then moved when the family sold the property and moved to Griffith Park. And it has a 99-year lease on the land from the, what do they call it? The people who love miniature railroads, the LA Live Steamers and Travel Town. Mm. And it's they're all in a row and they're so easy. It's on Zoo Drive, but it only opens on Sunday, the third Sunday of each month from 11 to 3. Bring your lunch. It's all beautifully landscaped and there are other things and there, his phone is there that he called the house to find
That's
out
right.
if dinner was ready. I mean, where do you find that?
Mm-hmm. Nowhere else but.
And then his Paraxo dispenser, his soap dispenser is there. And the mirror that he shaved in. I mean, come on. That is Walt Disney. Anyway, on top of that, I understand that there is a video. I've not seen it. But Robert and I went on a train ride. And we were the only ones on it. And it was special, and they told everybody, and they stood around as we came around corners and so on, with their cameras on and their videos going, and we were waving at them. Oh, it was so great. It was so Tinkerbellish. It was just amazing.
Oh, that sounds like a perfect send-off.
Oh, it was. And then when Floyd Norman came over, and I think his picture's out on the internet, of went down on one knee and handed me a picture that he had drawn of the characters, of Disney characters, and he signed it. It was just a very, very happy, happy special day.
Boy, that must have been the most emotional week of your life, getting married and then appearing at Walt's Barn before you moved across the country.
But you know, it in a way it was, but in a way it wasn't. I think Mark Davis did a really good job of choosing me to be Tinkerbell. Because people would say to me, you have lived, maybe I told you this, but you have lived in California for 90 years. Won't you miss it? And I said, no, I've seen almost everything in it. Now I can hardly wait to the next adventure.
Yeah.
So, and if I could only make my phone work most of the time, and I have to get a new one, you know, I'm talking to these wonderful people back and forth all the time. They fly in. They will be flying in. I will see them at shows. And so, but it's new for me. And that's something really, really, really good. And I have somebody who cares, you know?
Yeah.
It's very special, but Tinkerbell is always what's around the corner. Look over there. There's the ocean. No, I haven't seen that ocean. That's not the Pacific Ocean. That looks like the Gulf. Oh, it is, for heaven's sakes. I must be in Sarasota. You know?
Well, just like Tinkerbell, I mean, for you, you know, you're talking about your next adventure, and I know you have some live appearances coming up.
I do.
Can you just mention for the Skywalkers which ones you have coming up?
You know, I don't have my calendar in front of me, but let me get back to you. And maybe you can announce it. I am going to Marshfield. It will be on my webpage too.
Okay.
I'm going to Marshfield in April. That is for the Cherry Blossom Festival. And believe it or not, having a lot of people from World War II, historians and grand sons of presidents are going to be there, and all kinds of people like that. And they want Robert or Bob I can't make up my mind which I like better. Anyway,
Mr. Bogey,
yes. called BHB is his name. You know that my name now is Margaret Kerry Bogey.
Oh, there you go.
Well, you know, we can say that the Cherry Blossom Festival, that's going to be in Marshfield, Missouri, that will be held on April the 23rd through the 25th.
That's right. And I'm giving the talk. On the 26th at the church meeting. They have a wonderful church there, and they've asked me to give the talk. And I said, me? Talk? Well, I'll try. And Nicholas Inman, who's putting it all together, dropped his phone, I swear. So we will be flying back on the Sunday. But, oh, we have the best time. It is just great fun. We have an old-fashioned ladies' breakfast. We also have a tea. We also have, I've forgotten for the fellows because I didn't go there, but they go back and forth between something new and something very old, traditional. It's a wonderful match. And that's where I met the granddaughter of President Nixon. Mm-hmm. I met the grandson of Winston Churchill. I met the two senators. So they come. And it's just, yeah. And they do they kick up their heels? They have a grandson.
Well, it sounds like a great place also for us to meet Bob and or Robert.
And hopefully next year we'll meet him at D23 Expo.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
So will your book be ready by then? You're working on a new book now, correct?
Yes. Oh. I have the first two pages. I have rewritten the first page three times, and I think that I've got a handle on it. And of course, what I was planning to do was so that I don't have to go through the publishing nonsense. I don't know whether it will work, but I thought once I got very short chapters, I would post them on my website so people could read it. Wouldn't that be fun? Nice.
That would be great. What's the subject matter on this book?
St. Valentine's Day.
Oh, there you go.
The working title is Love at Second Sight. And our song is Unforgettable. That's what you are. Unforgettable, so near, so far. And it was sung at the wedding. So it's a working title, but I should be getting something on my website. I would say, I'll let everybody know on my Facebook when I will do it. But I think in about 3 weeks, I should have about the first 5-6 pages to start it. And then maybe a week later, some more, and then some more.
And they'll be able to find that on TinkerbellTalks.com?
Uh-huh.
Okay, yep. Great.
Yep. And as I say, the working title is Love at Second Sight.
Oh, okay.
That is fantastic. And so what we got to do is find all these videos of your wedding and you at Walt's barn and put them in our show notes, because these are just fantastic stories.
Oh, I love it. I love you guys. Yeah, the first time that we sat down at KKLA, it was just, you know, we just knew each other. That was it. And the idea that you're going to take something that you love and fans of things that you really, really love and make something wonderful out of it for other people. I just always thought that was so great.
Oh, well, yeah. Thank you so much.
We love talking to you. We love hearing all these stories. We love finding out the history of Walt and Mark Davis and how these films came about. And we're just so happy to have you in our life.
Well, invite me again, will you?
Yeah.
Will.
Margaret, we love you so much. We miss you, and we can't wait to see you again.
So God bless you both.
You too.
So great talking to you. And go give Bob a big hug from us.
Yes.
I'll give him a hug. Okay, dear.
Okay.
Bye-bye. All right, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Shout outs, Skywalker, shout outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was
We want to give a shout out to Joseph Zbornak. He is starting his own podcast, but in the meantime, he wrote up a lovely piece on StarWarsEditor.com about his top 10 favorite podcasts. And we are so thankful he picked us as number 2 on this very illustrious list. So thank you for the shout out, Joseph.
He had his top 10 favorite podcast, and then he had 20 honorable mentions.
Oh, wow.
He had a lot.
Wow.
So we made number 2. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
We appreciate all of you who listen to lots of podcasts. All right. Well, this is kind of a thank you from me because it was my birthday. And I just want to give a big thank you to everyone who posted happy birthday wishes on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and our Facebook group. Those of you who shared pictures and GIFs, it was so cute. You guys all wished me a happy birthday, and I got hundreds of comments and birthday wishes, and I read every single one. So, Skywalkers, you are amazing, and I want to thank you so, so much. And I also want to give a special shout out to Teresa Delgado, who shares my birthday. And she made a touching photo collage of us and said, "This girl is my best friend in the whole world. Finding her is one of the best things that has ever happened to me. We just happen to be twins in so many ways. I am so glad we have the same birthday, and I'm so glad that we found each other. Love you and have a great day today." Aww. I love that. And we are like weirdly twins. We both grew up in Austin, Texas. We both have the same exact birthday. We both... I'm trying to think. Like, it's just crazy, like, all the things that are so similar. It's great.
What would be the one difference between you and Teresa? The one difference?
That we're 4 years apart?
There you go. All right, moving right along.
What were you going to say?
I don't know. I don't know. She's, like, a half an inch shorter than you?
Is she? I guess. Who knows? I don't know. It's just so funny.
Okay, well, she always says how dark she is. She's on the dark side.
That's right.
You're on the light side. So you're two sides.
There
you're
two go.
Different sides of the same coin.
I love it.
Okay. Whew. Work through that one within seconds.
All right. And another shout out to Jeff Fishbach on Twitter, who wrote, "Finally, finally, finally got caught up with my friends Jedi Tink and Sithrich on Skywalking Pod. Never want to get that far behind again. Their positivity and joy for everything Disney, Star Wars, Pixar, and Marvel is so infectious." And Michelle, who is at Mick Bell, responded, "They are truly the best with their infectious joy." Aww.
Well, thank you, everybody. Much appreciated. This is one of my favorite parts of the show, is reading all your comments.
Absolutely. And we love going live, too. And like all your comments really, it's just so great. We thank you guys for being here.
Okay, everybody, let's take it from the top.
Something's happening.
And snap.
What's next?
The future. That's our specialty.
Woohoo!
So this week, I will bring out a few highlights of what's coming to Disney Plus, and the first one is Stargirl. Now, this is a Disney Plus original film that's based on the New York Times best-selling young adult novel by Jerry Spinelli of the same name, Stargirl. And the movie is directed by Julia Hart and is about a normal high schooler, Leo Borlaug, who is played by Graham Verscher. And he's terrified to stand out, as a lot of high schoolers are. But in comes the free-spirited Stargirl, Caraway, who is played by Grace VanderWaal. And Grace VanderWaal got her start on, what is it?
America's Got Talent.
Yeah, America's Got Talent. And so in this film, Stargirl stands out in both demeanor and clothing. Like, she's just out there, one of those out there people. And Leo is inexplicably drawn to her. So the movie is about how they meet and, you know, change each other in the process of getting to know each other. And one of the fun things in this film, an Easter egg, if you will, Giancarlo Esposito is in it.
Does he have the darksaber?
He does not have the darksaber in this one. Oh. In fact, he plays a character we're not used to seeing. He is the mentor role in this film.
All right. So he's not a crime lord?
No, he's not a crime
lord. Not a drug runner?
No, he doesn't.
Not a moff.
He doesn't do a big bad guy monologue.
All right.
No.
And we have more on Stargirl in our last episode.
Yes.
And we just wanted to continue with this week because this is premiering on Disney Plus on Friday, March the 13th.
Yes.
And that same day, we're also going to get Star Wars, The Clone Wars, episode Unfinished Business. And also on the same day, March 13th, we're going to have an episode of one of our favorite new series, Sarah, Shop Class.
Shop Class.
Was it Kelly and Courtney Turkel who said they were really into Shop Class?
I think so. I think they mentioned that was
this
fun.
This is another reality show where you have different shop classes.
Mm-hmm.
Who work in metal and wood, they all got to compete building something.
And it's made up, each team is made up of two kids and one...
Shop teacher,
yeah. So, and they're from all around the world, or I guess all around the U.S.,
mm-hmm.
and they compete, and this week, the episode is called Ramps and Champs, where teams are challenged with turning iconic school items into skate park obstacles.
Oh, nice.
So fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, we've been enjoying this one a mm-hmm. lot.
Oh, yeah, very much so. It's our new guilty pleasure.
Yeah, in fact, Dad, I think you'd like this a lot. Hint, hint.
Now, those were the highlights on Disney Plus. And last week, we were talking about watching The Mighty Ducks. And Sarah, for your birthday, you wanted to cuddle up on the couch and watch The Mighty Ducks.
That's
and
right.
And we did.
We did. Oh, we love it so much. Yay.
And you wanted to show me this because I've never seen this, because this came out at a time where it was a little bit out of my age range.
Oh, yes, definitely.
But you were only 11?
I was right in that age range, yeah. Man. That was to me. Yeah.
So tell us about some of the reactions you had while watching this, some of the flashbacks.
Oh, okay. So, well, for me, honestly, it's so interesting to watch these movies that I saw between like 9 through 13 or something, because basically my favorite movies were films that inevitably had like a French horn solo in the soundtrack.
Like, that was it?
No, but or really good music. So the sound design of this film is awesome. Like, not only is the music really good, it's by David Newman, the score, and there's this one moment where Emilio Estevez is like having his, you know, epiphany, he's trying to find himself again, and there's this horn solo that's playing as he's, you know, playing hockey and learning to love the game again. But also the sound design of the film is just, it's so cool because like when the hockey puck goes past the camera, you hear this big whoosh. And like when someone kick, you know, it's just like over the top, but in a really cool way. And there's also this moment when the two rival teams meet up towards the end and they're all like saying the...
Pledge of Allegiance, or the
Star Spangled. They're singing.
Oh, right.
Star Spangled Banner at the beginning of the game, and instead of hearing the music, you hear this big like drum solo going on, and it's like very loud and deep and like dum 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 dum. It's just so cool. I just really enjoyed seeing that movie again, and I think it was just as good as I remembered, which I was very happy about.
Not that this is a reboot or a remake, but I was just thinking, this is the 90s version of the Bad News Bears.
Yeah.
So instead of baseball, it's hockey.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of doing the exact same thing like remaking the old baseball film, they're remaking it with hockey.
Right.
And that wasn't their intention. Their intention was... This was a marketing ploy to market their new hockey league, kind of like the way they did with Angels in the Outfield. They
was created it really? The Angel.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Oh, yeah. It was all a big marketing. This was a big commercial for the new NHL team they created called the Mighty Ducks.
But it was really good. Like, the first film was awesome.
Yeah, yeah. And it you could see echoes of the Bad News Bears.
Yes.
You have the tough kid
you have the dorky kid, you have the small pipsqueak kid, and even in D2, the Mighty Ducks 2, you had some elements of Bad News Bears and Breaking Training. Mm. So it was fun to watch it with that in mind, with the Bad News Bears stuck in the back of my head. Now for Mighty Ducks 3, if they go to Japan, well, there's no hiding what they're trying to do here.
Okay. Well, okay, so Richard, I didn't really get to talk to you after we saw the original, the Mighty Ducks. Mm-hmm. So what did you think?
It was really aimed for the 11-year-olds, and I can see how back then you would just go along with it, whereas adults now, we have to pause it every couple of seconds and go, oh, come on, who's going to fall for that? With that in mind, never watch Beverly Hills Cop, never watch Ferris Bueller's Day Off again. That's all you'll be doing.
Okay.
So there were some moments that I just know that for the target audience in the theater, they're going to be rolling in their seats.
Oh, like laughter? Yeah.
Right. But for us, like,
well, okay, what about, I mean, there were some really good emotional moments in the film. Did mm-hmm. that get you at all? Or not really?
This was targeted for the emotions of an 11, 12-year-old.
Okay. I got
it. So I could see their intent.
Yeah.
And I can't say, for me, who's a few years older than 11 or 12, I can't see it through my eyes because you got to watch it through the intent. And that's for the younger audience.
Okay. Well, thanks for watching it with me, though.
Of course. We're halfway through Mighty Ducks 2, and you've got your reservations about watching Mighty Ducks 3 now, don't you?
I do. Yeah. Some of the Mighty Ducks 2, I'm not remembering, so I'm wondering if I ever watched those, and I thought I did.
We really should to get caught up on the series that's coming on Disney Plus.
Yeah.
If we don't watch Mighty Ducks 3, we're going to be so lost.
Oh, I know.
And it's funny watching these little kids going, hey, that kid grows up to be this person. That kid grows up to be that person. Like little Joshua Jackson.
Right. Yeah. He's like the main character, or the main boy.
Charlie.
Anyway. Charlie in the Mighty Ducks. And
he's also on Dawson's Creek.
Yeah, Jackson.
I don't know what Dawson's Creek is.
Yeah, it's Dawson's Creek.
Yeah.
Yes.
Uh-huh. I don't know that.
And then Foggy.
The tough kid. Because every of these sports movies got to have the big tough lone wolf kid. And that, we're looking at him going, who is that actor? Who is he?
So they dyed his hair black for these films.
And he's much younger than we know him now. And that is, he plays Foggy on the Netflix series Daredevil.
Mm-hmm.
He is Matt Murdock's assistant, his law assistant. Not assistant, but law co-owner.
And he's got like blondish hair, right?
Yeah.
Which is why we couldn't place him right away.
Once you know it, once you know, hey, that's Foggy. Well, that's him right there.
Yeah, you can't unsee it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's fun to watch that, if only for those references, too.
And watching those 90s hairstyles.
Oh, yeah. Well, that does it for episode 280 of
Skywalking Through Neverland. We'd like to thank Margaret Kerry for coming back on the show and telling us all about her big day. And, of course, we want to thank all you Skywalkers for listening every week, watching our YouTube videos, and watching us right here on YouTube.
We'd also like to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations. Are you thinking of a trip to Disney parks? You can fill out a Get a Quote form at smallworldvacations.com today. Their vacation planning service is free of charge, so check it out and tell them Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
And where else can you find Skywalking Through Neverland?
Well, you can find them at jedinews.co.uk and Fanthatrax.
Now, we are part of the Skywalking NETwork.
Skynet.
Where you can find other great shows like Sabers and Spells, Talking Apes, and classic Marvel Star Wars comics.
You can also find us on social media at Skywalking Pod for Twitter or Instagram. You can join our Facebook group where there's lots of fun conversation and discussion there, so just search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland Group. You can email us, share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. And if you feel like supporting Skywalking Through Neverland, head to skywalkingforce.com.
All right, Skywalkers, thank you very much for joining us once again. Now stay tuned for bloopers and other fun bits of conversations that didn't fit in the show. So, until then,
always remember
to do as much in one day as Margaret Kerry does in one day.
Never land on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Ogushewitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
You know what? I should really pour myself some water.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
First.
Yeah, go ahead.
Have it by the side.
Okay, oh,
that's a good idea.
I'm walking. I'm pouring. Oh, that was easy. It was on the refrigerator. There you go. Well, it took me, I never knew that it was wild to be able to have to change your name.
Oh.
You know, men don't do this.
No.
But women do.
It's been 10 years since Sarah and I got married, and most of her mail still has her maiden name. So, yeah, it does take a little while. So, yeah, you'll be close to 100, and it'll all be sorted out.
The Clone Wars. Are you ready for On the Wings of Keeradaks? Now, is it Keeradaks or Keeradakis?
Keeradaks. That's the way it's spelled.
Yeah. For some reason, in my head, it just flows off the tongue if you say On the Wings of Keeradakis. I don't know why.
Nope, I don't
and
say
I'm
that
wondering
well.
If that's reminded me of something. I'm not sure.
Hey, John. Apparently, Toddy's doing a bang-up job getting rid of these spammers.
Thanks, Toddy. You're hired. All right, Skywalkers. Well,
thank you, everyone, for watching. And thank you, Tatia, for getting rid of those bugs.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah.
You're hired.
Yeah, thank you, John.
All right,
thank
bye,
you, everyone.
And Richard, you got to go.
Yeah, I got to get to work.
All right.
Have a great one. You too. Thank you, everyone. Yay. Thanks, everyone, for watching.
You know, there was always somebody there. There's always Rick Law, for example, who is an artist, an illustrator artist for Disney for many, many years. He helped me all the way through when we lost our email. It went off by computer, completely gone. Mm. He spent 5 hours getting it back on. I have no idea. And then it got back on, and all the emails that I had before, the 17 that were sitting there that had come in, I don't have anymore. They are lost completely. It's like, no. It's heaven. It is heaven. I don't have 300 emails sitting for me to go through. I shouldn't say that. I shouldn't confess to that, but it was wonderful. It was terrible. It was wonderful.
You know, somewhere out there is a Nigerian prince looking for your help.
And what is that? I'm getting a beep, beep.
Uh-oh.
On this phone.
It's not.
I think it's just someone trying to call in to your phone. We don't hear it.
Yeah, we don't hear it on our end.
Okay.
Hey, Margaret, guess what tomorrow is? Tomorrow is Sarah's birthday.
Oh.
That's my birthday, yeah.
Oh, hey, you know what? Can you say a special happy birthday to Sarah so we can put it before your segment?
I will.